a choice. We can go around looking like, or we can rejoice. You know, I don't understand the Lord as I probably should. He doesn't think like I think. It's probably a good thing. What do you think? But this is a day that the Lord has made. And I will rejoice no matter what anybody else says. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen? Amen? Yeah. All right. Are you going to start us off in prayer?
I can do that.
Why don't you start us off in prayer?
The Lord gave me a voice. That walk by grace, talk by grace, and everything is in love by your precious name. Amen. Well, and
the power of the Lord.
Guys, I just want to say something. Jesus is the center of it all. You know what? That's why we're here. And why we're praising Him and worshiping Him. Let's make Him center even now. We're singing the words. Don't let them be words. Let them be the song from your heart to Him. That He is the center of my life. Amen?
Amen.
Sorry, guys. Start it up again.
Shout it.
Lord, we just acknowledge that it's all about you. And not about the corona stuff. It's about you. And Lord, we are coming to you this morning, you who are our great physician, the author and finisher of our faith. We are coming to you this morning, Lord, and we are asking for your healing touch upon our lives, the lives of this community, Lord God. Lord, keep safe, Lord God. Bring healing. And Lord, I ask for that healing, not just to be physical, but mental. Because Lord, for me, too many people are panicked. And they're giving into their fear, not understanding that it's all about faith. And faith in you. And so Lord, I ask for your blessings upon our time together here today. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, you can be seated. Things are a little differently here today, huh? You know what blesses me? Is that we are just about maybe one or two shy now, because they just left, of what the requirement is by the CDC. And that's what I put on the doors, unfortunately, because we want to be in compliance. Why? Is because if they come in, and anybody can come in at any time and start shooting pictures and see too many people here, or there's not a safe distance, they could come in later on and shut it down. Now, they'd have a fight on their hands with me. But just want to be prepared and do this the right way. Amen?
Amen.
Got some announcements here and stuff like that. I got a couple things I want to talk about. Hasn't this week been kind of an interesting week? Somebody got a joke on YouTube. It was the year 2050. And the person, was a very special day for the person as he went into the bathroom that day, because that would be the last row his parents bought for him back in 2020. Sorry. Couldn't pass it up. Well, welcome to Living Waters Fellowship, where God's healing waters flow. We have three pillars in which we stand upon. The first pillar is evangelism, each one reach one. The second one is discipleship, building up the house of God within each person. And the third is to make a difference in our community for Christ. I want to encourage you, and I've heard some great stories already coming out and what those within our body are presently doing. And I am just blessed beyond measure. But two of our three pillars, each one reach one, and to make a difference in our community for Christ, is where we are right now. What can you do to help someone that you know? Give them toilet paper. Or pine cones, but I won't go there. But how? In other words, we have to help one another. And so, you're helping in the name of Jesus. And so, check on your neighbor. How you doing? Just want to come over and see if you're okay, if I can do anything. Several in our body have already put offers out there that if somebody is housebound and cannot go anywhere, that they'll go pick up the groceries and stuff for them. That's what this is about. It's not some big program that we put together. It's us being what God has called us to be. That's what's going to make the difference. So that's what I want to encourage you with. As we look at these pillars, this is what these pillars are all about. These are not just something we say. This is not something that's written in our bulletin to make us out, ooh, like a church. These are written because this is the way we need to live. And discipleship, That's growing in our love of Jesus Christ. And so I want to encourage you this coming week, who can you reach out to? Reach out to them with the love of Jesus. Since there's no first-timers here, we don't have to worry about water bottles. But we do have a maxim that we like to repeat every time we come together. Will you repeat it with me? That we are mighty men and women of valor because we are greater in the eyes of God than we are in our own eyes. And while our hearts may condemn us, God is greater than our hearts and knows what truly lies within. Can I get an amen on that one? Man, yeah. Well, as always, we want to be able to give of our tithes and our offering. And so if I could have the ushers kind of come and get themselves ready, please. And the ushers will pass the bag to you. You won't have to take the bag from them and pass it down the way. So I know that there's... Okay. There we go. 1 second. Let me drop that in there. Someone gave that to me. Okay. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this time, Lord, because we realize this, that giving of the tithe is not just giving of money, Lord God. It's another part of our worship of you. Because you have said that we are to give unto you. That the tithe, the first 10% is yours. And then you said to bring it into the house of God. And so, Lord, I thank you for what you are doing, Lord God. I know that there's many that are here that are going to be struggling. And so, Lord, I ask for your provision for them. Lord, however it is that you would provide, Lord God, that you would provide for them, that there would be miracles beyond what we can even imagine. And so, Lord, I ask that you would help all of us to fully understand the grace and mercy that you have for us. And I ask this now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And so they're kind of walking with the bags up and down. First of all, if you got a cell phone like me, when I walked in, it kind of dinged on me, so I realized it wasn't turned to vibrate. So turn it to vibrate, turn it off, whatever you'd like to do. This coming week, most everything, we had the choir practice, but that has been canceled. Your home groups. If you are a part of a home group, please check with your the person who is over it or with the hostess and find out if they're still holding it. We don't know. This is a week-to-week sort of thing that we're in. And so please take a little bit of time and get with them, or they will get with you, one of the two. Wednesday, this will be our last Wednesday night in which we will be having both men's and women's study. Ladies, this is the end of the study. Paddling too?
So why are you still paddling?
I always call it paddling too. I said, no, that's not yet. But this is the last of that particular teaching. And so what we're going to do is that we're going to give this time. And part of the why we're giving it time is to let people know we're going to be cleaning. I want to tell you something. This place is probably cleaner than a hospital. Maybe. Might just be. Everything has been wiped down, sanitized by the CDC's requirements. It has been deodorized.
Sanitized.
Top to bottom, bleach with water, chairs, everything. You want to see my hands? Yeah, they're glowing, yes. But that'll give us a chance to rest the building. And I say that kind of interesting because whatever, if something does get on something, it takes 3 to 5 or 6 days to go. So we want to be, by the next time we come together, we're going to have it all cleaned. It's all going to be sanitized before anybody walks into this place. But we want to make sure and everybody knows that your safety and people's safety is our primary concern. We want to make sure that you, when you come in to worship God, you can worship God and not worry about anything else. So that's Wednesday night. This will be the last Wednesday night for a while, and we'll let everybody know as we go along. My prayer is that everything's going to blow over in another couple of weeks and we'll be doing good. Again, the Women's Essential Conference, they canceled it. The Foursquare
The head of the Foursquare office, they canceled it because of the virus that's going around. Those of you who have paid directly to them for it should have gotten an email. If you haven't, give them a call, give me a call, I'll get you the number, whatever it is, and they will refund. But you need to do it. If you just leave it there, they'll donate it. They'll put it to a donation. So that's to let you know. And if you've put money to the hotel, you got to call that hotel up. Second, the New Believers class, or the basis of our faith, because there's only a couple of people and what we've been doing here, Denny asked if we could do this a little differently, and this may make sense, because what we'll probably end up doing is putting this particular class on video, so that people, when they come to know the Lord, can start right then and there, and they don't have to wait until enough people are there. And so, you know what? We got our plans. God's got His plans. We never know why God does things. This might be another reason for this, is that we kind of catch up with the 21st century. We also were in the point of ordering in our pew Bibles here. Where our goal is to get 75 Bibles, and the goal is this, is underneath, we'll have three to four in every aisle. So there'll be enough that when we get into the Word, like we're going to be getting into today and then tonight, that we'll have it. Plus of all, it's not the one that's 7.5 print that you need a magnifying glass just to see a word. It's 10-point. It's going to be standard book size. So that's what that is for. And I don't know where we're at with that one, but I know Nick was about ready to get everything done for it. Our Sunday night service, because Pastor Mike is still not feeling well, we're still going to be having it. And so I'm going to be doing it again tonight. And then tonight's message is called The Power of Faith. So as you can see, we'll have everything together. It's just more intimate time we get together. Questions are asked and answered at that time. Talking about the Sunday night service and the Pew Bible and the rest of it and what we do, I got a couple of emails just this last week, and I'd like to share them with you because this is for you as well. I don't even know who this guy is. He's a pastor from New Jersey. He saw what we were doing. He said, "Dear friend, I'm glad to read from you. Greetings to all." I guess somebody sent him the email or the Facebook thing. "Greetings to all my brothers and sisters. Sickness or disease will not imprison us. We will not be put to shame. We'll testify to the faithfulness of Jesus Christ. God will lead us and defeat all our enemies, and then we'll live and increase. We will walk in His obedience. Amen. Thanks." I don't know who this guy is. But you know what? Somebody sent him the information. And in New Jersey, they're shutting everything down. So this is, that does my heart well. I just got another one yesterday. Actually, last night, from India. "Such heart-touching sermons and devotions. I'm going through and learning a lot of new things. I will surely use your devotions and sermons to teach our people, and we'll see a great harvest of souls, and we'll translate those sermons to disciple our people. Thank you for the great blessing." And our pastor friend out of the Philippines, who's been working with us almost on a weekly basis, he's in the rural part of the Philippines. Philippines, I can't even say the name. And Bruce, you don't have to laugh so hard back there. We can hear you, Bruce. Okay. He said this, and this came through actually this morning. He said, "Thank you so much again for your very encouraging and powerful sermon, Recovering What's Lost." That was last Sunday's message that posted on your church website. "Your sermon has blessed us here in the Philippines." He takes the sermons and then he uses them and he teaches his leaders who go out into the other areas of the Philippines, into the rural community, and teaches them. also has a group of leaders that he himself helps. So this is, we are reaching beyond our community in ways that sometimes you don't know. And I want to tell you, this is one of the ways in which you and our church are reaching out in the community beyond our community. And so we're making a difference. And Paul says that, and I saw that Tanzania, we're trying to figure out where that was. But the podcast is reaching Tanzania now. So, guys, this is what it's all about, is sharing the love of Jesus. And so I'm just really stoked at what God is doing for all of us and doing with our study here. So with that, if you would, open up your Bibles to Matthew chapter 21. And before we get there, we will sing our song. I don't have to tell you, you all know it. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Melt me, mold me, fill me, use me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. And Lord, that's what I ask, that you would fall afresh on us today. Do a new work in here, Lord. Do a new work in our hearts. Lord, where our prayer may truly be, Lord, change me. That you would change each and every one of us. Because we know the situation and whatever we are facing, the situations change because we change. Because you are doing that work inside of us. That is when we see the situations around us change, because we're changed more for you. So I ask for this blessing now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, Matthew 21, as you know, we're continuing on this journey towards Easter. And we're looking at the different roads that Jesus took, along with those roads that he is asking, or pathways that he is asking us to take. Now, last week, we looked at the road that Jesus, or the path that Jesus told us to take if we want to make it into eternity in heaven to be with him. And that was the narrow way, or the narrow road, the narrow path, as opposed to the wide way, or the wide road that leads to destruction. Today, I'd like to look with you at the road that Jesus took to Jerusalem and his entrance into the city as he readied himself for his upcoming death. Now, the Oscars, are the Oscars over? They're over? That's good. I'm so glad that's over. But the Oscars are where the movie stars, all the movie stars come out in all of their regalia in order to have a grand and glorious entrance. But I can guarantee you this, they're not driving up in an old beat-up VW van, wearing some old tennis shoes, $5 jeans, and a little torn T-shirt. They're coming in chauffeur limousines, and they're dressed to the nines. Given an opportunity to make an entrance, most of us would choose the grandeur style over that of mediocrity or poverty. We'd choose a blazing white stallion over the small gray donkey. And it was such a grand entrance that the disciples of Jesus were hoping to witness when he entered into Jerusalem on that day. They were hoping for some grand entrance on a blazing white stallion, something like the Lone Ranger with the cloud of dust and a hearty Heil Silver, and go in Jerusalem and kick all the bad guys out. That's what they wanted. That's the Jesus they wanted. And that's the type of Jesus that most of us want as well today. But Jesus entered Jerusalem differently, and upon a road that isn't as easily traveled, a road that isn't as easily followed. In fact, it's a road that not many, if any, would choose for themselves. It's a road that leads to the Father's will and hence to our destiny, which means it's a road that leads to death. Jesus knew this. That's why, and he said the same thing to his disciples. He said this, "We are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and the teachers of the law. They'll condemn him and put him to death and turn him over to the Gentiles to be mocked and flogged and crucified. And on the third day, he will be raised to life," raised from the dead. Yet even knowing the pain and suffering that was waiting for him, Jesus still went. There was a deep determination in Jesus' heart on his part to travel on this road to Jerusalem and to his death. And we see this determination in Luke's account. Luke said this, "Now it came to pass when the time had come for him to be received up, that he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem." In the same way, we need to steadfastly, we need to have our faces determined deep within to follow this road that leads not only to our death, and when I'm talking about our death, I'm talking death to our wants and to our desires. But we also need to know this, that it's a road that will lead to our resurrection as well. We forget that part. See, we always concentrate upon I can't do this or I can't do that. Then you follow this Jerusalem road. Yeah, we're going to go to the death of our wants and our desires. But you know where else that road leads? That road leads to the tomb and to the resurrection, where we'll be with Jesus for the rest of the eternity. Once this life is over, we're in heaven. That's where this road eventually leads. As Jesus entered into Jerusalem, it was a time of Passover. This was one of three feasts in which the Jews were commanded to keep in Jerusalem itself. And so they headed to the Passover. Now, Passover, if you want to put it, what is it kind of like? You can kind of say, well, it's kind of like our Feast of Thanksgiving here. Because for the Jewish population, for the Jews, Passover is a time to celebrate what God did in delivering them from their bondage and captivity to the Egyptians. So by the time Jesus entered, you have to know this, by the time he entered, everyone had heard of him. They heard of his great wisdom and how he put to shame the religious leaders of that day. They also heard of his healings and miracles. They heard how he had fed 5,000 with a few fishes and a couple loaves of bread, and also how he raised Lazarus from the dead. And so they lined the streets crying out, "Hosanna to the Son of David." And basically, if you were to look at that, it means, "Messiah, save us now." But what these people wanted was diametrically opposed to what the Lord was doing. Jesus didn't enter that day in order to set up his kingdom. Instead, he entered that day, he took the road to enter Jerusalem to die on the cross in order to save people from not just their Roman oppression, in fact, not from the Roman oppression, to save them from their oppression, to save them from their captivity and bondage to sin and death. That's why he came. And so the Jerusalem road for Jesus was the beginning of the end of his earthly life. And although it led to the cross, it was also a road that would lead eventually to heaven with him sitting at the right hand of the Father. And so when we take this Jerusalem road, it will not only lead to our own deaths, that is, death to self, but it will also lead to our eternal destiny in heaven. So let's take a look at this event. It's in Matthew chapter 21, and we're just going to read from verse 1 through verse 11. Says, "Now when they drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethage, the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, 'Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord has need of them. And immediately he will send them.' And all this was done that it might be fulfilled that which is spoken by the prophet, saying, 'Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, a foal of a donkey.' So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt. They laid their clothes on them to set him on them. And a very great multitude spread out their clothes on the road. Others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The multitudes who went before those who followed cried out, 'Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!' And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, 'Who is this?' And so the multitude said, 'This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee.' I'd like to share with you four things that I see on this road that we need to understand if we're going to take this same road in our own journey of faith, which we are called to take, our own journey down this Jerusalem road. And the first thing I see about this road is that it's a road of humility. When we think of Jesus as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, our first thought, we immediately think of His coming down from heaven. He's coming down from heaven in dazzling white clothes, whiter than anything we could ever possibly imagine, riding upon a white horse. That's how we imagine the coming of Jesus as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But that's not how He entered Jerusalem on that day. Instead of grandeur, Jesus chose the road of humility. He didn't come riding on a great white stallion. Instead, He came riding on a lowly gray donkey and his colt. In fact, it wasn't even his donkey. It was borrowed. Yet this reflects the life of Jesus led. Jesus didn't come into this world wealthy. He came into poverty. He didn't enter into grandeur. He came in meekness. And His life wasn't one of fame and fortune. Rather, He lived outside of the limelight and wanted to live outside of the limelight. In fact, Jesus always spoke about His kingdom being that of servanthood and not rulership. To His disciples, Jesus said this, "I tell you the truth, unless you change and become like little children, you'll never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever humbles themselves like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." Not only did the disciples not understand this, but also there's a lot of us that we don't understand this as well. None of the disciples understood Jesus' purpose. Even on the very last night, that night of Passover, as they're on their way up to the Mount of Olives, they were arguing about who was going to be greatest in the kingdom of heaven. They still didn't get it. They didn't understand this road of humility that Jesus was walking, and by all appearances, neither do we. We need to get off our white stallion of pride and of over our self-achievements and get on a small gray donkey of humility. We need to put away the thoughts of grandeur, much as Jesus Himself did. We saw this as we looked at this 2 weeks ago. But in Philippians 2:8, He says, "And being found in the appearance as a man, He humbled Himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross." What does that say? He did what? Humbled Himself. Here is the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, the Lord God Himself, the second person of the Godhead, who did not think it a wrong thing to be equal with God. But what did He do? He made Himself of no reputation. He humbled Himself. And that's what He's calling for us to do as well. It's this kind of humility that Jesus was walking. And by all appearance, like I said, neither do we. Of the Jesus, the Apostle Paul said that in Philippians 2:8. Being found in the appearance as a man, He humbled Himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. And this kind of humility, God not only sees us like this, but He exalts in us like this. This is seen in the story that Jesus gave of the Pharisee and the publican. What's a publican? A publican was a Jew who collected taxes for the Roman government. Everyone hated him. He was the IRS of that day and that time. Anybody like getting a letter from the IRS? No. In fact, in that day, they are the lowest of the low and considered the worst of all sinners. And so the Pharisee and the publican, they went into the temple in order to pray. The Pharisee went forward, congratulated himself, talked about how good he was, his great works, talked about how his giving was, and how he wasn't like all these other bad sinners that was in this place, especially that publican back there. See, that's how we often come to God, prideful in who we think we are and what we've done. The publican, on the other hand, entered the temple staying as far back as he could. He basically entered the temple. He walked in, and he probably went like this, staying all the way to the back. And then he hung his head. He beat his chest. And he said, "God, be merciful to me, a great sinner that I am." And because of that humility, Jesus said, and that repentant heart, Jesus said he left and God saw his prayer. He left justified, it says, in the eyes of God. And that's it's that kind of humility that God wants us to have as well. That's the type of humility that the Lord dwells in. Isaiah 57:15 says this, I live in that high and holy place with those whose spirits are contrite and humble. Wow. God dwells with those whose spirits are contrite and humble. I refresh the humble and give new courage to those with repentant hearts. The Lord is saying here, not only does he live in the high and holy place, but he also lives in the lowest of the low place, and that is in the heart of those who are humble. What a dichotomy, but that's the Lord. And so the first thing we see about the Lord on this Jerusalem road is that this road of Jerusalem, or this Jerusalem road, is a road of humility. Second, it's a road of fulfillment. Jesus' entrance upon the colt of the donkey didn't happen by chance. It was direct fulfillment of God's divine plan. 500 years earlier, God not only planned his entrance. I'm sorry, I just got this kind of off there, okay. Didn't plan his entrance, but he also chose the mode of transportation. This is seen by the prophet Zechariah in 9:9. This is over 500 years earlier. Some say about 550 to 560 years earlier. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. This is one of many prophecies we see in the Old Testament in which Jesus fulfilled when he came. In fact, if you didn't know, Jesus fulfilled over 300 prophecies of the coming Messiah when he first came. Can you imagine the odds of that? The probability? I mean, the probability that somebody would fulfill that is mind-boggling. So, Peter Stoner, who's a mathematician, not because he smoked, but he was... I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said that. It just kind of snuck out. He figured out the odds of one person fulfilling just 8 of these prophecies, of which this one is one of them. And the probability is one with so many zeros behind it, we can't even imagine. I mean, it goes beyond our comprehension. It's like, what? And so he tries to give to us a visual of what this looks like. How big is the state of Texas? Huge. Big. Okay, consider the state of Texas. And he said, and you fill the state of Texas 2 feet high, not like that, with silver dollars. How many silver dollars do you think that is? Guess what? They can't tell me. I looked. Couldn't find it. Couldn't even find how many silver dollars were in until I was told, old Dennis, there's different sizes of dollars. I went, oh, thanks. But consider that. 2 feet, whole state of Texas, silver dollars, and you take one of those silver dollars and you mark it. And you put it wherever you want to put it. On top, in the middle, in the bottom, by the coast, by the north, east, south, anywhere in between. Doesn't matter where you put it. You just put it. The chance that one person fulfilled 8 of these prophecies is the same as a blindfolded person being dropped off wherever they want to be dropped off at and picking up that one marked silver dollar on the first try. That's the probability of one person fulfilling just 8 of these prophecies. So the road to Jerusalem was a road of fulfillment. Jesus' life was to fulfill God's plan of redemption, that is, his plan to save us. Therefore, Jesus took the Jerusalem road for our salvation. He took it for our salvation, knowing full well that it meant His death. The question God would have for us then is whether or not we were fulfilling His plan for our lives. Jesus traveled this road full, knowing full well that it would lead to His death, but also that it would lead for a better life for you and me. Jesus died so that not only do we have eternal life in heaven with Him for all eternity, but so that we can have an abundant life right here and now as we fulfill God's calling upon our lives. Jesus said it like this, You did not choose me, I chose you, and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatever you ask the Father in my name, He may give you. Apostle Paul, after telling them that we are saved by grace through faith, and not of ourselves, it's a gift of God, not of works, as anyone boast. Verse 10 says this, for we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. We have been created in Christ Jesus for good works, He says, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. What He has called for you to do, He prepared from the very beginning of creation, and probably before that, before time even began, before there was anything called time. He designed this life for you. He had this destiny for you. I'll get to that. I'm working in front of myself. Now, part of this, let me just go to this part. Part of this fulfillment is giving to us the Holy Spirit. Jesus said that the Holy Spirit would lead, guide, and show us how we are to walk on our own Jerusalem road. That road that we are traveling. And not only will the Holy Spirit help us fulfill God's calling, but when we're disappointed or discouraged, and when this discouragement and disappointment sets in, He will be our comforter, bringing aid and giving relief and helping us in our time of need. And so Jerusalem's road is a road of fulfillment that we must be willing to follow in order to fulfill God's plan, purpose, and will for our lives. So this is a road that we must follow. The third thing we see about this road to Jerusalem is that it's a road of obedience. Jesus' life was one of obedience. Jesus said, my food is to do the will of Him who sent me and to finish His work. For I've come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of Him who sent me. He fully obeyed. Even coming down was obedience. And there in the Garden of Gethsemane, knowing that He was going to be then scourged and crucified, know what He prayed? Not my will, but your will, the Father's will, be done. And while the disciples obeyed Jesus, when He told them to go get the donkey and the colt of the donkey and bring it back to them, and then if somebody says, hey, what are you doing? Just say, hey, the Lord has need for them. They're going to let you go. How many of you guys would think that's nuts? It's kind of like, you know what? You need to go over to that parking lot over there and you need to get me that Range Rover. And if somebody tries to stop you, just say, oh, Dennis wants it. Oh, okay, go ahead. Yeah. And yet they obeyed. He gave them some pretty weird commands. And they obeyed. Yeah. But He also gives us some pretty weird commands too. I said it. It came through. But God's ways are not our own. God tells us to go do things that won't make a whole lot of sense. I'll be honest with you. They don't make a whole lot of sense. But in obeying, what we find is that God had a plan all along. I'm going to say this. I don't know what God's plan is for this virus, but He's got a plan. He's got a plan. Kind of goes back to what happened to me years and years ago. About 28, 29 years ago. No, well, maybe 30. After the stores closed down, I became the West Coast sales manager. That's just a fancy title. I was the only one on the West Coast for a wire and cable company. And it was getting successful. I had just secured one quarter of the Hughes Aircraft wire and cable bid for all of their government contracts. One quarter. My commission would have been several hundred thousand dollars for that. I also had several government contracts that I just got finished with government contractors or the government itself that was quite substantial in money. One was over a $30,000 commission in my pocket. As I was looking over the orders, making sure everything was correct, actually, as I started looking over the orders, I heard this: I got you out once the hard way. I know the voice of God. I immediately closed the book, went to my pastor, and says, I've got everything set up. Everything is here. You can have do it. You can, all the prophets can go to the church. I mean, you know this one, and you've seen me go through it. You've got hundreds of thousands of dollars, but when God says he got me out the once the hard way, I heard that before, I'm going to follow him. The man was smart enough to listen and know that I wasn't playing games on this one. He saw the orders. Four weeks later, after I shut everything down, gave all the things back to the home office, all those commissions, everything else, I just gave it all back. Hughes Aircraft lost their major corporate contract with the government, in which most of the wire and cable was going to be sold to and for. Also, several of my government contractors, the manufacturer shipped it to them wrong. In the end, I would have been losing money instead of making any. God's ways are not my ways. His thoughts are not my thoughts. And I'm so glad. Of course, Publisher Clearinghouse wouldn't be bad. Well, after everything was done, a little while later, God opened the door and provided me the funds. Because you had to realize something. I was living month to month trying to make mortgage payments and everything else. But he opened the door for me at that point to go to seminary for 2 years. And then I came back and took over the church that I helped start in Las Vegas, Calvary Chapel of Las Vegas, which is now Living Grace. That's Pastor Richie's church. Would that have been my way? No. But it was God's way. The Jerusalem road is one of obedience, and it calls for us not only to hear, but to obey the voice and the word of God. And so the Jerusalem road is a road of humility, fulfillment, obedience, and finally it's a road of destiny. The people were spreading out their clothes and palm branches in the road, crying, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Basically, they're asking God to come and save them now. These were the words of Jesus' destiny, though. For Jesus was destined to die for our salvation, even from the very foundation of the world, it says in Revelation 13:9. His destiny was to die so that God's plan of salvation could be fulfilled. And here's the really ironic part. Those same people that were crying out, Hosanna, Hosanna, come, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, were some of the same people that were crying out, crucify him, crucify him. But not even Pontius Pilate could stop this destiny when he tried to switch Barabbas with Jesus. Jesus' destiny was to bring a new destiny to humanity. A destiny that was lost back in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. And to do that, Jesus not only was destined to die, but he was also destined to rise from the dead and destroy sin and death. And guess what? Not even Satan could stop that destiny. And that's our destiny. What is destiny? Destiny is God's purpose for our lives. It's our appointed and ordained future. Destiny is what God determines for us to be and to become. It's sad when I see those within the Bible who miss their destiny. That's sad to me when I see that. Kind of like King Saul. God chose Saul to be king over Israel. And looking at 1 Samuel chapter 10, God promised that the Spirit of the Lord would descend upon him, that he would prophesy, that he'd be turned into another man, and that God would give him another heart. Wow. Saul started off right, living his destiny. But in his pride for self-gratification, he broke and compromised God's law. In the end, he missed God's destiny. And we heard this in his own confession. He said, God has departed from me and does not answer me anymore, neither by prophets nor by dreams. In serving himself, Saul ended up abandoning God. But I have to be careful trying to compare our destiny to those of in the Old Testament. Why? Because God in Christ has done a new thing. And in the cross, he's gathered all of our destinies together. Yes, we all have individual destinies. We all have gifts and talents. We all have different callings that God has given to us. But the really neat thing is that we all have the same fixed and predetermined destiny. Do you know that? I like what the Apostle Paul said. He said it so eloquently. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to become adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will. Yes, our destinies have a lot to do with what God has called us to do and is allowing us to do in this life in his name. But we all also have the same destiny. What's that same destiny? To get to know Jesus better. To walk blameless in his sight. And to become a child of God through faith in Jesus Christ. Our destinies, however, do not end with our life here on earth. Rather, they see us all the way into eternity. One person's gravestone, in fact, I was talking with someone just last week, and the story came up, and so I had to look it back up again. But on one person's gravestone, this guy had written this on his gravestone. Pause, my friend, as you walk by, as you are now, so once was I. As I am now, so you will be. Prepare, my friend, to follow me. One person took issue with that, with this person's perceived destiny. And so in chalk, he wrote underneath it, to follow you is not my intent until I know which way you went. The Apostle Paul said, I myself no longer live, but Christ lives in me. So I live in my life in this earthly body by trusting in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. We dare not separate ourselves from the destiny that God has for us, which is to die to self and become like Jesus Christ. Jesus traveled down this Jerusalem road, and that's what he's calling for us to do as well. It was his destiny, and this Jerusalem road is also our destiny. The Jerusalem road is a choice. Jesus could have easily chosen not to walk it. We have that same choice. But personally, I'll tell you something. The consequences of that choice scares me to death. Why do I say that? When Jesus was crucified, there were two thieves that were crucified right next to him. The first one chose, and he chose to ridicule and mock Jesus. The second one chose, and he chose to fear God and to believe in Jesus. And it was to that choice that Jesus says, today you'll be with me in paradise. What will be your choice? Will you continue to go the way of the world and have a different destiny than what God has planned for you? Or will you choose to follow and obey and have heaven and eternity with God as your ultimate destiny? Today, are you traveling down your own road? Or are you traveling down Jerusalem's road? Today, are you living God's destiny? Or are you living your own? It's our choice. What did that Knight Templar in Indiana Jones say? Choose wisely. Will you bow your heads with me, please? Heavenly Father, thank you so much for giving us this opportunity to look into your word and to see this road, Lord Jesus, that you took towards Jerusalem and your entrance into that city on that day. Not just to fulfill your destiny, Lord God, but to fulfill your destiny for our destinies. Lord, I ask that you would help us to choose wisely, that we would choose your way over the way of the world. And once again, Lord God, I want to bring up all those who are suffering, all those who are going through the pain that have been infected by this virus. Lord, I ask that you would be with them, that you would heal them, and Lord, that you would stop this virus in its track. You know what? The Lord told me to read this morning, so let me just read it to you. Psalm 91. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him I will trust. Surely He shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler, from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid by the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by the day, nor the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor the destruction that lays waste at noonday. 1,000 may fall on your side and 10,000 on your right side, but it shall not come near you. Only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. Because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place. No evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near to your dwelling. For He shall give His angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways. In their hands they have bear you up, lest you dash your foot against the stone. You shall tread upon lions and the cobra and the young lion and the serpent and shall trample underfoot. Because He has set His love upon me, therefore I will deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name. He shall call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I'll deliver him and honor him. With long life I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Lord, these are your words, and this is your promise. And so, Lord, may we always keep our focus clearly upon you. Have our face set towards you, and not upon the things of this world. Because your promise is that darkness will not overwhelm us. The arrows will not pierce us. The pestilence won't even come close. So, Lord, I ask for your blessing and help us walk in your way and help us walk on this road, this Jerusalem road. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Could you stand, please, as we end our time together? And I just wanted to end with the same song that we ended with last week as well.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided. turning back. No turning back. No turning back. No turning back.